Hi everyone. Happy St. Patrick Day, everyone. So today we'll continue with our class, and let me share my screen. So until now, the type of programming that we learned in this class was procedural programming. We learned how to write loops, how to write methods, how to use simple data structures like arrays. Today, we start a new kind of programming, which is objects and classes or object-oriented programming. Again, if you have any questions, please either write it in the chat or ask it loudly. Basically, unmute yourself and ask the question. So again, the type of programming that we'll start learning today is called object-oriented programming. And initially it originated with graphical user interfaces. So Smalltalk was the first object-oriented programming language. And basically it was a programming language in which one would develop a graphical user interface, also called GUIs. And they need multiple instances of the same kind of classes of objects. Like for instance, two buttons, input fields, multiple input fields, check boxes, choice boxes, and so on. And this is the perfect application of a case when you want multiple instances of the same kind of graphical user interface component. So basically, you would develop one complex object. And this object is not only that it has multiple properties, like color, what happens when you click on the object, the event handler, form, font, and so on. But also it has methods. So basically you can assign not only a structural view, but also a behavioral view to the object. There were structures before in C, but they were just a way to see one object with multiple properties. What graphical user interfaces brought was the fact that you also have behavior that is associated to that specific object. And that's what we will learn today and in the following lectures. Basically, we'll learn object-oriented programming concepts. So first of all, we'll start with objects. So objects in programming represent any entity in the real world that can be distinctly identified. An object is created based on a template. In Java, this template is a class. A class that has multiple fields, like for instance, person class has first name, last name, address, and so on. An object instance of person must have a first name field, a last name field, age, and so on. So basically, an object is created out of a class or a template and has a unique state and behavior. The state is the set of all the values for its data fields. So the data fields or the properties are individual components of the state of the object. So when we define, for instance, a circle class, a circle has a radius, maybe has a color. These are data fields. And the set of all of these key value pairs, basically name of the data field and what is the value of the data field, is the state of the object. Now, in addition to the state, you also have the behavior of the object, which is the set of what are called instance methods. They are the methods that are not defined as static in Java. So the non-static methods are actually instance methods. They can only be invoked for a precise object. For instance, again, taking this example of a circle, a method getArea would use the internal value of the radius to compute the area of the current circle. So also for object-oriented programming, there is a visual language, which is called UML, Unified Modeling Language. And basically the idea is one of the type of UML visual languages is called class diagrams. And in class diagrams, you can represent a class with a rectangular that has the class name, followed by the data fields in a separate area. and followed by the instance methods, these methods that are specific for every single individual object. In addition to the class diagram, you also have objects in this UML diagram. If you want to represent multiple objects, like circle one, circle two, circle three, are instances of the class circle, and each object has a different value for the data field radius. So the first circle has a radius of 10, the second circle has a radius of 25, the third circle has a radius of 125. So you have a visual representation for the class and visual representations for the objects. One thing that you don't see in the object representation are the methods, because the methods are inherited. If circle object one is an instance of a circle, then by default, it has the method getArea. So for this circle object one, we can invoke getArea and it will compute the area of a circle of radius of 10. So let's return to Java. So classes are templates that define objects of the same kind in Java. In Java, a Java class, if you remember at the beginning of the semester, I said that a Java class is a program, but also is a template that allows one to define a class, basically a class of objects. And in Java, classes use data fields, variables to define the data fields, and non-static methods to define the behavior. Like for instance, getArea is a non-static method that returns the area of the current circle. A class also provides a special kind of method called constructors. So these constructors are actually those methods that are invoked when you want to construct objects of that class. And there might be multiple constructors for the class. You may have a default constructor that takes no arguments, let's say for circle, that creates circles of radius of one. Just basically that you want to have a default constructor. If somebody calls it, they get a circle with radius of one. But you can have other constructors as well. You can have a constructor that takes the radius as a formal parameter, like we have in methods, and it creates a circle with that specific radius. Okay. You can have another constructor that takes the radius and the color, or the radius, the color, and if it's filled or not, and so on. So let's see an example. So we have the class circle. The class circle defines a data field radius, which by default is equal with 1.0. So this is the only data field of this class. Then we have two constructors, one default no argument constructor, which by default you invoke it, you get a circle of radius of one, and another constructor that takes a double formal parameter, new radius. And this new radius is assigned to the data field radius. So basically you construct a new circle with that specific radius. Then we have a method, a non-static method. You see it's public double get area, and it returns the radius multiplied with 3.14159, an approximation of pi. So basically you get a method getArea that returns the area of the current circle. So you see, it doesn't take any parameters because it will be invoked for a circle object, and that circle object already has its own radius. So here we have actually a public class test circle that in the main method, it creates two circles, C1, that's a new circle with the default no argument constructor, and circle two that creates a new circle of a radius of 5.0. And for these two circles, we can get their radius. If they are not private variables, we will see that here I use the default modified field. So it's not a private variable I can access and read for circle one, the radius. Similarly, I can access and read and also assign new values to circle two radius. And I can also invoke the method getArea. So getArea returns the area of circle one based on the internal radius of circle one. And similarly, get area for circle 2, this dot parameter, this dot operator, which basically allows us to call a non-static method for an object, it will basically invoke get area and will return the area of a circle of radius of 5. So that's an example of a class and a test class, a driver, what is called a driver, to actually create multiple objects, instances of that class, and get different properties and different data fields and different behaviors, non-static methods for that class. So before we continue, let's actually do this in Java and see exactly how what's happening and how is it happening. So I'm going to open Eclipse. Let me close this test and create exactly what we have in the lecture notes. So I'm going to create a class. Let's call it circle. It doesn't need a main method. I will use a separate class to create a main method. And here we have double radius is equal with 1 by default. And then I have two constructors, public circle. So one thing that you can see about the constructors is that they don't return anything. This is a method that doesn't return anything. And that's actually not true. It's not that they don't return anything, but they return a circle. They return an instance of the current class. The constructors have the same name with the class, and they return an object of that class. And you can only invoke them with a new operator. So let's create a second constructor, circle that takes a double new radius. And internally, we assign to the radius data field the new radius. Okay. Then we have, let's say, a couple of methods. One is public non-static method. We don't write static, double get area. And for get area, we return radius multiplied with radius multiplied with 3.14159. Maybe we also can return public double get diameter. And again, it takes no parameters because it has the radius internally. And we return two multiplied with radius multiplied with the value of pi, 3.14159, and so on. Actually, diameter is just to multiply with the radius. I was thinking about perimeter. So that's basically a couple of methods in the class circle. Now we can create a separate class. Let's call it test circle. And this one has a main method. And this one creates objects instances of that first class. So let's create a circle C1 is a new circle with the default constructor. And then we can actually see the fact that for C1, the radius is 1. So C1's radius is C1.radius. And similarly, we can get the area of C1. So C1 get area is equal with, and for these non-static methods, you use the same dot operator, only that instead of getting a data field, you're getting the value written by a method. So get area. And similarly, let's say just copy it and we get the diameter. And now I can create a different circle. So circle C2 is a new circle, and I use the second constructor in which I pass 5.0 or 5 as a parameter. And then for C2, we print all of this. We print its radius, which will be 5, and then its area, which will be 5, the area of a circle with radius of 5. And I meant C2. Okay, so let's actually run it. So I'm going to run it first without the debugger. So this only shows you that C1's radius is 1. C1's area is the area of a circle with radius of 1. C2's diameter is 2 multiplied with 1. C2's radius is 5, because that's a circle with radius of 5. And then the area and the diameter are area and diameter of a circle of radius of 5. And now what I want to show you is, if I put a breakpoint here and also one here. So let's see what's happening. So we basically run that and it stops at that line. And now we go into. So we go into the method get area. And one thing that you notice here is that the radius for this circle is 1. So invoking for circle 1, the getArea method will basically have internally the radius as 1. Now, if we continue, we stop here, and again, we go into to look at that method. For second time, when you call getArea, the same method, but for circle 2, circle 2 has a radius of 5. So this actually shows to us that we are actually executing getArea for the specific circle for which we invoked it for. So for C1, we get the radius of C1. For C2, we get the radius of C2. So these are two different objects, and these methods are executed for each one of these objects individually. So when we go to the circles, we actually, this radius is the radius of that exact object. In fact, in Java, there is a keyword called this. This is the current object. So basically, you can use it in front of your data fields to specify that I want the radius of the current object. Now, because there is no other variable radius here, there is not a problem. This keyword is used when you have some variable that is hidden by a local variable. Because I could have used here radius as the variable in the first constructor. The problem here is that you are taking the value of radius and assigning it to the same variable radius, the formal parameter. So this is a place where you must use the this to specify that radius here is the same with this one here as a formal parameter, but the radius here is actually the data field radius for the current object. This is the current object for which we invoked this radius. So the keyword this in the method getArea is optional, because if you don't have it, it basically infers that there is only one radius, which is for the current object, which is the radius that is defined for as a data field for this class. But when that radius is hidden by a formal parameter or local variable, you need to precede the data field with the keyword this, meaning that this is the current object. Okay, and for this current object, we want its radius to be assigned the formal parameter that was passed as a parameter. But we will get more into this keyword this a little bit later. It's used for multiple reasons. One reason is to access the data fields of the current object. The second reason is to call from one constructor another constructor. So for instance, let's say that I'm doing some operations in the first constructor. Maybe I'm defining the color or something. And I don't want to replicate that same code into the second constructor. So instead of replicating that code, the first call in the second constructor is the first constructor. But instead of calling it with the name of the class, like circle open close parentheses, we call it with this open close parentheses. Basically, we call from one constructor, we call another constructor. And then again, that's a reason to use this. Okay. So these are the two uses of this, but we'll talk more about this later. For the moment, I think it's clear the fact that classes can be used for as templates to define data fields as the state of the objects. And then there are constructor methods that are used to create objects. And there are non-static methods or instance methods to get a method that is specific to that specific object. So these non-static methods, they use data fields as internal variables. And the second thing that we saw was the fact that we can actually use this class, in this example, circle, to define a variable, and we can instantiate that new variable with the new operator, and then use the constructor for that class to create an object of that class. You have seen this new operator when we talked about strings. So remember that when we talked about strings, we gave some examples like string S1 is equal with a new string. And then we specify the content of that string, like hi. So string is also a class, and there is a constructor that takes a string and creates a string object with that specific content. So similarly to that, you can have another string, S2 and S3, and each one of them may contain the same thing or contain different things, but really you have different objects, instances of the class string. Okay, so let's start with the visual representation. So UML class diagrams. This is the unified modeling language, UML. It's a general purpose developmental modeling language in the field of software engineering. And it's intended to provide a standard way to visualize the design of a system. It's an easy kind of language that can be used when you discuss the project with a customer. You describe to the customer that this is the type of templates, that what kind of information you want to store about the users or about the data in your system. And so this UML modeling language has different kind of diagrams. There is sequence diagrams that are basically describing how methods are calling each other. There are use case diagrams for how a user interacts with the system, package diagrams. But the diagram that we will use in this class, CSC 160, is class diagrams. They are the building block for creating object-oriented modeling. So there are classes, or basically you have the class name, the data fields. The data fields are followed by colon and the type of the data field. And then you have methods. And usually they start with the constructors, and then you have other methods. There are a few more notations that we will actually see later, which are to do with if a data field is public or private. We'll discuss about that later. Once you create classes, you can also create objects. So an object like circle one is a circle, circle two is a circle, circle three is a circle, and each one of them has a different radius. You can draw these kind of diagrams with multiple tools. If you search on Google for UML diagrams, you will find a lot of different tools. The one that I find most intuitive is called Violet. So Violet is basically a very useful Java program that allows you to build different types of UML diagrams. The ones that are most common are, again, class diagrams. So you can create a class. I can basically show you here, double click on it, and let's create a class for a person. So a person has, let's say, data fields, first name of the type string, maybe last name of the type string. There are other types. So for instance, maybe age, which is of the type int, and so on. There are also, if you want, there are also data fields that are static. That means that they are for the entire class. So for instance, let's say that count, how many objects somebody created with this class person is a static data field. Okay. In UML diagram, usually they are underlined, but in Violet, I cannot have underline. So I basically just use this static modifier in front of the data field. And then we have methods. So the first type of methods that you are going to put are the constructors. So for instance, here we have a default constructor. Then I have a constructor that takes maybe the first name and the last name. First name as a string and last name as a string. And also maybe the age as an integer. Then you have other methods. For instance, accessors. Accessors are methods that get the values of data fields. Instead of giving access to the data field itself, we give an access that returns a copy of the data field. So get age, it returns an integer. Instead of actually using the age data field, we will provide the method get age to return the age. There are also static methods, like for instance, static get count of how many objects have been written, have been created of this type of class. So this is, in our case, all that we probably want to represent about person. There are many other relationships between classes. Later this semester, we'll see that sometimes you want to define a subclass of person. Maybe I want to define student, and the student inherits everything from person. And in addition to that, it also has a GPA, which is a double. And maybe additional methods, like for instance, I have constructors for student. Maybe I have a constructor for student that takes the first name, the last name as a string, and maybe the GPA as a double. And I may also have some methods, like for instance, get GPA, which returns the GPA of that student, double. Okay. So how do we state the fact that student inherits all the properties of person? We use inheritance. Basically, have a special type of relationship between student and person that states that a student is a subclass of person. And you can have multiple subclasses of person. You can have another class that extends person. Let's say that maybe this is employee. Employee is also a subclass of person, and maybe an employee has a salary. And that's a double. and additional constructors and other methods. And again, in UML, that's represented with subclassing. Now, another, so Violet is one, and in the lab for today, you will actually see that I put a link to Violet. So in today's lab, at the end of the, there is download Violet from this website, or you can use draw.io. So draw.io is basically a flowchart diagram that is connected to Google Drive. You can create a new diagram. Let's just create a blank diagram. I will use the root folder. And there is a special UML diagram type of entities. So again, you have classes, and you can basically write your class name, like circle, the data fields. Minus represents private. So for instance, radius is a double. And then you have methods. Let's say that I have the constructor for circle that takes radius as a double, doesn't have to return anything because constructors don't return anything. But then there are additional methods. So for instance, I have get area that returns a double. So these are the two tools that I'm personally using for UML diagrams, draw.io and Violet. Violet is good because you can use it even if you don't have internet connection. Locally, you can save the file after you basically draw the UML diagram that you like. It's saving it into a HTML format, which can also be loaded later. So this is person. And similarly, you have automatic saving in the case of draw.io. So this is already saved into my Google Drive. I can go back and export it as a JPEG, or I can actually modify it in any way I want. Similarly, in Violet, you can export it as an image file, and then it basically it will be exported as an image file. PNG by default, you can change it to JPEG. Okay. I see two questions in the chat. Minus stands for private, and plus stands for public. So what is a private data field? A private data, so the idea is that you don't want to give access to your data fields. So for instance, here I did give access to my radius. So in a different class, I can access it. However, if I define it as private, now I can't directly access the data field. So it will tell me that you can't, or you must create getters and setters methods. So what is a getter method? A getter method is a method that returns a copy of the value. So public double get radius. And all that it does, it returns a copy of radius. So what's the advantage? Because now I can still get the radius. I can use get radius. But I can't modify the radius. So basically, it gives me a copy of the radius. And that's better because it may be the case that I don't want the user, somebody that uses my class, to put a negative radius. Okay. So I want to give access to my radius. So in addition to this get method, I can also define a set method, public void set radius to some double radius. but only then I modify the radius if the radius is positive. So if radius is greater than zero, then this dot radius, which is the data field for radius, is assigned radius. So the advantage of this is that it can only be used to set the radius to positive values. Okay. So now let's modify, let's save this. Let's say that I invoke for C1 set radius twice. So first I set the radius to 2, and then I set the radius to minus 102. Okay. Now, one thing that you can see if you run this is that radius of the circle C1 is still 2. So the second one did not work. And that was because I basically checked this in the set radius method. So why is this better than just having the radius as non-private variable? Because if it's non-private, then you can actually write something like this. C1.radius is assigned minus 102. So now you get circles with negative radiuses, which are impossible to obtain in mathematics. So basically the idea is that by setting data fields private, you make them invisible to other classes. So now you can't do such thing. You basically, this is a syntactically incorrect thing in Java. So that's why you have setters and getters, or modifiers and accessor methods. Those are what are the correct words. Yeah, okay. So that's the question that I saw in the chat. Okay, so let's continue. So constructors. Now let's dig into constructors. So constructors have the same name with the class itself. In our case was circle, was the name of the class. Circle was the name of the constructor. Constructors do not have a return type, not even void, because it's not void. It basically, the constructor is to construct an object of that class. You don't have a return type because it's known that you are returning an object of that class. You can only invoke it with a new operator, new, and then you invoke the constructor. Constructors are invoked with a new operator when the object is initialized. And what they return is a reference to that object. So you have class name, object equal, new, and that class name. For instance, circle, my circle is equal with a new circle of 5.0. So these are all reference types. We talked earlier this semester that there are 8 primitive types that contain the value. All of the other variables are reference types. So my circle will be a reference to a new circle of radius of 5. Now, until today, you haven't defined constructors in a class. However, you have a default constructor. So when you don't declare a constructor for the class, a no argument constructor with an empty body is implicitly declared in the class. So remember all our previous classes. For instance, let's finish this object, this class, this object. Okay. And we had this class test. Okay. Test has a constructor, the default constructor. This is what I'm saying here, is that a class that is declared without constructors. A no argument constructor with the empty body is implicitly declared in the class. So that means that there is an implicit test constructor. I can create a test T1 object that is a new test because there is a test constructor. And similarly, I can create 3 more objects, T1, T2, T3, T4. And these are totally fine. This is actually a correct class that created four different test objects with using the default constructor in memory, and actually I got references to them, T1, T2, T3, T4. And if I want, I can print them. So I can print system.out.println T1. And similarly for T2, T3, and T4. And it will tell me that each one of these is an object of the type test. So it says test at, and this is the address in virtual memory that says that where that is. And it's a hexadecimal number. You can see that it contains letters like B, D, E, F, and so on. So basically there are four test objects. This is for test one, this is for T2, this is for T3, and this is for T4. And those are at different addresses in memory. So basically it prints the fact that that's an object of the type test, and it's stored at that address in memory. You can do much, anything, in fact, with those addresses. It's just the fact that it tells you that is a real object that is created in a heap at that specific address. So until now we learned that constructors must have the same name of the class, do not have a return type because they return an object. You are invoking them with a new operator and you're getting a reference, and you can declare and assign such a reference using basically the constructor. Also that there are no argument constructors added by default if no other constructor is in the class. One thing that you must be aware of is the fact that if you do have another constructor, so if I have public test that takes an int, maybe I, then you do not have the default constructor. So only then it happens that a class that doesn't have default construct, that doesn't have constructors, has by default an implicit default, no, an empty constructor. If you have other constructors, then you don't have an implicit empty constructor. So if you do want to have another constructor, an empty constructor, you must explicitly define it. You must basically define test, which is an empty constructor, and that's fine. But if you don't have such a default constructor and you have another constructor, then you don't have the default constructor. It's very interesting, this fact that the Java developers decided that if a class doesn't have constructors, you have a no argument constructor by default. But if you have other constructors, then you don't have no argument constructors by default. Now, if there is a question in the chat right now. Do all the data members get defined to zero or false or empty string given the default constructor? Yes, that's true. So the data fields have actually default values. If you return back to circle and I don't give a value to radius, then in test circle, when I just create a default circle, you will see that the radius is zero. So there are default values. So for instance, circle one had a default value of zero. Objects, as Greg points out, they get null. So for instance, if I have a public string, maybe color, and it's public, so basically I can access it. And here I print out the color. So C1 color is C1 color. It will print out null. Okay. So objects basically have default value of null. So by default, numbers are zero. In this case, because it's a double, is 0.0. strings are null. Let's say that I have boolean b by default is false, and car c by default is the character with Unicode 0. Okay. So those data fields, you can access them with a dot operator. So you have the reference variable for that object, and then dot, and then you have the data field. For instance, myCircle.radius, or myCircle.color, or myCircle. All of the proper data fields that we had defined. Similarly for objects. So those instance methods, you can invoke them with object reference variable dot, and then the method name and the arguments, if that method takes arguments in addition to the data fields for the current object. So for example, myCircle.getArea returns the area of my circle given the radius internally in my circle. So here is an example. I define circle, my circle. This basically what it does, it creates my circle as a reference to a null object. This has a null reference. Then I create with a new operator, a new circle with radius of 5. When assignment happens, the address of that new circle is copied into the reference variable my circle. So you have basically a reference to this object in the heap. Then I create a new variable, your circle, which is also null. It has a null reference. The new circle default constructor creates a circle of radius by default of 1. That was the value that we gave to radius by default. And then when assignment happens, we are assigning, we are copying the address of that circle into the reference value. And then if you have assignments like this one, your circle is equal with radius, it basically modifies the radius of that circle, your circle, to 100. So basically this is how it's executed and how the memory layout is. Now, we talked about static methods all the semester up to now, and non-static methods, the instant methods that we talked about today. So static methods are those methods that are shared by all the instances of the class. They are not specific to some object. Like for instance, math.pow. You invoke it with all of the arguments given. So basically you are asking, give me 3 to the power 2.5. And basically this is how you would do it. You would prefix the method pow with the class from where that static method is. Math, the dot operator, and then the method pow, the static method pow. Now you also have static constants. So for instance, here, all of these were non-static, but I can have a static integer count. And maybe every time that I'm creating a circle, I increment the count with 1. So now, because this is also invoked when I create the circle with a given radius, it always, every time I create a circle, I increment with 1. And maybe I also have a public static integer getCount method that returns the count. So basically, this is a static data field. It's shared by the entire class. So when I basically add 1, it adds to the 1 variable that is count. So for my test circle, after I created the 2 circles, I can actually ask how many objects I created. So I created this many circles. And here I have circle dot get count. So basically I invoke, this is a static method. I invoke for this method, this count, get count, I basically get a count. I could have done it also because that was a public data field. I could have done it also as circle.count, just the name of the data field. So in either case, it will tell me now that after I created two circles, I created two circles. So those are static methods. They are shared by all the instances of the class. You invoke them with the name of the class. There are static constants, which are final variables shared by all the instances of the class. So for instance, if I want to define in circle pi, I can define it also as static final integer pi assigned 3.14159. So, and actually I can define it as public, and it's not an integer, it's a double. So this is a static data field. So I basically have a constant that is only stored once in the class itself. Okay, but it's basically static, similar to the variable count that I had before. Now, the non-static instance methods, they must be invoked with an object. So instead of invoking them for the class itself, you must have instance variables that belong to that specific to a specific instance, and instance methods that are invoked by the instance of a class. So for instance, get area, you invoke it for my circle. Similarly, if you have a non-private, like for instance, public data field radius, you can invoke for my circle the radius. Okay. Any questions up to now? For some reason, the chat is disappearing when I start presenting. So I don't know if you're asking questions. So, okay, so now let's go to default values. So remember that Java doesn't assign default values to local variables defined inside methods. So for instance, if you have a main method and you have two variables int x and string y, and you try to print x and you try to print y, you will get a compilation error telling you that the variables are not initialized. But it does assign default values to class data fields. So for instance, if I have a student class with data fields name of the type string, age of the type int, Boolean is science major, and character gender, they all have default values. So reference variables are null. Any kind of numeric types are zero. Booleans are false, and gender has the Unicode for zero. So if you create in a test class a new student object, given that you have this class and nothing else, you have the default constructor for it, then student.name will print null. Student.age will print zero. Student.isScienceMajor will print false. And the gender will be the invisible character with Unicode zero. Okay. If the data fields has any other type of reference type, like not only string, but you have any kind of reference type, you will have the default value null. It's a special literal that says that this is the null address. This is no address whatsoever. Okay. So primitive data types, if you remember, are those that basically one of the eight data types in which the variable itself stores the value. Like if you have integer I equal with one, I is an alias for a location in memory that stores one. Object types, including the class circle that I created before. The class circle is a reference by default at the beginning before we assign anything to it, is a null reference. But once we assign to it a circle, like a new circle of radius of one, the reference is basically an address to an address of the to an object of the type circle whose radius is equal with 1. Okay, there is a question from Joel. The count is the same for all circles, but each circle can have different radius. Yes. And the reason for that is that the radius was a non-static. It was not defined as static, but count was defined as static. So static means it's like the static methods that we had before, which are invoked for a specific, for the class. Yep. Okay. Now, there is also a difference between assignments of objects and primitive types. So for primitive types, let's say that you had an I and a J, and I was 1 and J was 2, and then you have I is equal with the value of J. Basically, we copy the value of J into I. So now they are both 2. And if you assign to one of them something else, like I is equal with 3, then I is 3 and J is still 2. What happens even if you assign an object to another object? So let's say that before the assignment, you had one reference C1 to an object C1 of the type circle, and another reference C2 to an object of the type circle of radius of 9. So now we have an assignment. C1 is equal with C2. Basically, C1 and C2 are both referencing the same object. So basically now, C1 is the reference, an address of the same object with C2. Why is this important? For two reasons. First of all, what happened with the old circle? It's garbage collected. If no other reference variable is pointing to it, Java will go and automatically delete it. Second is that now you have two variables which are referring to the same object. So if you state later c1.radius is equal with 5, c2's radius is also 5, because you are basically looking with both c1 and c2 variables to the same object. So you have multiple references. When you have assignment of objects, you are multiple references to the same object. What happened through the assignment, we copied the address that was stored in c2 into c1. So basically now both C1 and C2 are pointing to the same object in memory. So what happened with the previous object? It was garbage. Basically garbage means that it's no longer referred by any other class, by any other variable. And garbage is automatically collected by the Java virtual machine through a process called garbage collection, which is automatic. It runs in parallel with your program. And basically what it does, it cleans the memory for you. In previous languages, like for instance in C, if you create an object, like for instance, this string that I created here, when you want to delete string, you would have to say it explicitly. You would have to say s1.delete. And from there on, don't use the reference s1. In Java, you don't need to do this anymore. Basically, the moment that you assign to S1 a different string, new string for hello, the old string is going to be removed from now on by the garbage collector. So you don't need to worry about that. You don't need to, before you assign a different string, to actually explicitly call delete. In fact, there is no such method anymore. This is gone. So basically, it takes care of this thing that you don't need to explicitly allocate space and delete space. And it was the same with C before even C++. So in C, in order to create a structure, you would have to allocate space with malloc to that structure. And when you delete it, you had to explicitly go and dealloc, delete the object from memory. Not in Java anymore. This is all gone. You just create the objects that you need, and Java takes care of cleaning the memory for you. So let's take a look at a few classes in Java. So the first one is the date class. So we talked about strings. Java also provides a system-independent encapsulation of the date and time in the java.util.date class. And it has various methods. You internally, it's actually stored as the number of milliseconds from January 1st, 1970, which is called the Unix epoch time. And basically, it's a long value of the number of milliseconds from that moment in time. And that was in time zone zero, so, or the universal time zone. So basically, you have internally the date is stored as a single long number. But there is a method called toString, which is actually a standard method of classes, which gives you a string representation for that date. So you can basically create multiple dates and then to invoke this method to give you what date is it. So there is a constructor for date that constructs a date for the current time. There is a constructor that you actually give that long integer elapsed time, which is the number of milliseconds since January 1st, 1970 GMT. The string method that returns a string representation of the date and time, the current date and time, or that object's date and time. Then there is the getTime method, which actually returns that number of milliseconds from January 1st, 1970. And there is a set method in which you can pass this long integer, and it will basically set the date to that object. So here I have an example. So basically you can create a new date and you can print that date and to see what it is. So let me clean up a little bit here. So we have a main method. I create a date and maybe I create two dates. So this is date two and I print one after another. So now basically it prints that it's March 17, Wednesday, 7:07 p.m. I want to catch a moment where it creates one object in one time second and another one in other, but that's very hard to do because it's milliseconds, 1,000 seconds, 1,000th of a second. Okay, so this is a class. There is another class called random, also in the Java util package. And this creates, you remember there is the math.random method, but if you want, you can create an object that has a seed as the seed to these functions to create random values. So the seed is a long value. So you can create a new random object that takes a new random of that seed. And you can get, given that seed, you can get different random values. Next int returns an integer random value. Next int with n will actually return an integer random value between 0 and n, excluding n, exactly like math.random does. Next long returns a random long value. Next double returns a value between 0 and 1, exclusively. Excluding one. Next float returns floats between 0 and 1. And next boolean returns a random boolean value, true or false. So you create a random object with a given seed. It's basically an additional input to the random function. Then in a loop, you can actually invoke the method to get multiple random values, maybe 10 random values. So let me actually show you this. So here I created two dates. Here I can create two random, one random object. So this is a new java.util.random of seed of three. So these are 10 random integers between 0 and 1000, not including 1000. I want them one under another. I prune them into, I don't think it's inclusive. I think it's exclusive. I can see that if I have up to 10, If I generate 10 numbers randomly, it should, it doesn't never generate 10. So you can see that is basically not inclusive of 1000. So the n is not included. Okay. Is there a difference between random and map.random? The function is a little bit different. The internal function to generate these random numbers. Basically, you give an additional input that will be used in this function, pseudo-random hash function that takes an additional value to give you better random values. So in the implementation, yes, map.random does not have this seed. So the function is different. Okay, so now let's again see the difference between non-static like radius and static data fields. So static data fields are represented in UML by underlying or putting within as a modifier in front of the data field that is static. And in our case, number of objects is static and get number of objects is a static method. So those two are underlined. Plus stands for public. That means that they can be invoked from other classes. Minus stands for private, meaning that you can't access those from other classes. For instance, if we have two objects, C1 and C2, circle one and circle two, they have different value for radius, but both values for number of objects are the same. And the reason for that is that number of objects is a static data field. It's stored only once for the class itself, for the class circle. Caleb is asking, is a larger seed more random? No, not really. Basically, it's just an argument in this hash function that takes the random, the seed as an input. So it's not more random, it's as random as it could be with any integer. Now, by default, classes, variables, and methods are called package modified. That means that if you don't have any modifier, public or private, in front of them, those data fields can be accessed or those methods can be accessed by classes in the same package. Then you can put in front of the method or data field public, meaning that it's visible to any class in any package. Private is the opposite. Basically, it can only be accessed by the declaring class in order to protect the data. As you saw in the previous example, in a set method, you could check if the input formal parameter is correct or not, like positive or negative and so on. But when you make it the data private, then you would basically can only access the data fields with get modif accessors and set mutators methods. They are used to read and modify the private data fields. And I think I show you that example in the class circle. So we define the radius as private, but then we defined an accessor get radius that returns a copy of the radius and the mutator set radius that takes a radius, checks if it's positive, and only then assigns it to the data field radius of the current object. So here I have a bunch of examples to understand the modifiers. So the private modifier again restricts the access within a class, the current class. The default modifier, that's no modifier whatsoever, not public, not private, just you define double X, restricts to any class within the current package. And public is unrestricted access. Anyone can access it. And here I have an example. I have package one, and in package one, I have a class C1. The class C1 has three data fields, X that is public, Y that is default, or package level modified, and Z that is private. Similarly, I have three methods, M1 that is public, M2 that is default or package, level, and M3 that is private. Meaning that from another class C2, if I create an object O of the type C1, I can get the value and access the data field X because it was public. Y, because C2 is in the same package with C1. And I cannot access Z because that was private. Similarly, I can access the method M1, M2, but not M3 because that was private. From a class C3 in another package, in the package P2, I can create an object of the type C1 by basically either importing the class C1 or prefixing the class C1 with the package P1. I can access the public data field X, but I cannot access the data fields Y and Z because Y was package modified, meaning that it can only be accessed in the current package, and Z was private. And similarly, I can invoke the method M1, but not M2 or M3. From here, I have another example. If I have a public class C2, I can access C1, that is, classes are also default modified. They can be default modified. So I can access C1 from the same package, but I cannot access C1 from a different package because C1 was default modified. I can access C2 because C2 is public. So that's the private, public, and default modifier. In UML, we use the sign minus. So minus is for private, plus is for public, and hash sign is basically kind of between, is package level modified. It's not private, it's not public. Now, another thing that you should probably know is the fact that you can create arrays of objects. So an array of objects is basically a reference to an array of references of every one of those type of objects. So for instance, if you create a circle array is equal with a new circle array of 10 circles, you basically get a reference circle array to an array of 10 references. By default, by the way, those are null, because in order to create additional circles like circle object 0, 1, and so on, you can create them separately. So you can basically, you must actually write something of the kind. Circle of 0 is new circle. And only then it creates this reference that circle of 0 points to a new circle. Otherwise, before that, circle of 0 was null, in fact. That's all for today. Do you have any questions? What's the difference between, let's say, a circle reference variable and the string reference variable? No difference whatsoever. Basically, they are both references to objects in the heap. Very good question. Okay. If that's it, thank you very much. And enjoy 20 minutes of St. Patrick's Day before the lab. See you in the lab in 20 minutes. Thank you.